The major difference comes from the actuarial gains and losses. So what happens in accounting standard 15 as you are aware? It is a single line item which affects your profit and loss account in that particular year. Whatever you have your actual gains and losses, it gets it comes in your profit and loss account and it goes off during the year. But in the accounting, in the IAS 19 rules, it doesn't come in your profit and loss account. It comes in the other comprehensive income. That means your profit and loss account does not contain any item as such which is an actual gain loss, and it goes out of your profit and loss account and it goes into your other comprehensive income. But in case of US GAAP, we use something called the corridor approach. Okay, but the US GAAP does say that you can have three kind of recognition of your actual gains and losses. One is immediate recognition, like we have in the accounting standard 15, or you can put it through OCI, like you have in IAS 19R. But predominantly, all the companies reporting under US GAAP, they do a corridor approach. What is it? This, they take only a portion of actuarial gains and losses and put it through your profit and loss account. The reason for doing this is, if your actuarial gains and losses are very large, the profit and loss account will be protected from the volatility. So, because you take only a portion of it. What happens is, an accumulated unrecognized portion of your actuarial gains and losses, excess of your corridor, which is your 10% of either your assets or liabilities or your retirement benefits, which is divided over your future service of the liabilities. So that small bit comes into your profit and loss account, which is called an amortized amount. I think you would have heard of, if you are reporting under US GAAP, you would have heard about these terms. So this is regarding the gains and losses. This is a major difference between all the three GAAPs. The next major difference is the past service cost. Typically, a past service cost arises when you change your plan. Suppose you are, let's say for example, if you have a gratuity plan, currently it is a limit of 10 lakhs. Now tomorrow, but then you should be aware that though the minimum limit is 10 lakhs, the government does permit the companies to do an unlimited gratuity plan. So today if you decide, okay, today you are giving 10 lakhs, okay, you want to be more generous to your employee, okay, move from a 10 lakh limit to unlimited. So there is a change in the benefit plan. So in that case, you incur a past service cost. Now, this past service cost treatment is different in these three GAAPs. In the Indian GAAP, typically if you have a change in your benefit plan, what happens is your vested past service cost gets recognized immediately in your profit and loss account. The one portion which is non-vested, which will be deferred, it will be deferred over the period of non-vesting period. Typically, the vesting part arises because in gratuity, you know, the vesting period is 5 years. So, if suppose in the third year, if your plan changes, only up to the period of third year, which is vested, will get recognized in the profit and loss account. And the balance portion, the next 2 years, which is unvested, which will get recognized in the next 2 years. That is the accounting standard 15, the local GAAP. In case of IAS 19, erstwhile IAS 19, the treatment of the past service cost was similar to the accounting standard 15, our local GAAP. But now with the revisions, the past service cost is recognized immediately in your profit and loss account. So now what's going to happen is, if you're going to have a huge change in your plan, there will be a huge volatility hitting your profit and loss account. That year particularly, when the year in which you change your plan, benefit plan, there will be a huge hit to your profit and loss account and there will be a huge loss. So that's what the revised provisions in IAS 19 states. In case of US GAAP, again, the treatment of past service cost is similar to your actuarial gains and losses. You need to amortize your past service cost in the same manner as the actuarial gains and losses. Curtailments. Typically, a curtailment, past service cost is when you are changing your plan, that is when the past service cost comes. Curtailment, typically, if a company decides to downsize, then the curtailment comes into play. So, the reason for distinguishing between past service cost and curtailment is because the company wanted a proper disclosure with respect to these kind of costs. So, a person who reads your financial statements are aware that what goes into curtailments and what goes into past service cost, and it will be read as change in plans and downsizing of the company. The treatment of curtailment is similar to the past service cost. It is similar to past service cost as far as the local GAAP is concerned, and as far as the IAS 19 revised also, the treatment is similar to your past service cost. In case of US GAAP, in case of curtailments, it is similar to the actuarial gains and losses and passives. So that means it is amortized over the future periods. The fourth, these all are, if you look at it, all these are profit and loss account items. It is affecting your, it is called the expense, what you call in your, if you look at your disclosure, something called the net periodic pension cost, which hits your profit and loss account. And these all are the profit and loss account items. The net interest, this is a new, actually this term is pretty new. I have used this term because of the IAS 19 revise. What if you see your disclosures, you find two items. One is the interest cost, which is typically the interest on your liabilities. And you have the expected rate of return on assets, which is your, as the name suggests, your expected rate of return on your asset, which is backing your liabilities. I use the word term net interest cost here because of the revisions in your accounting IAS 19. The IAS 19 has merged both these items now, and instead of calling interest cost on liabilities and expected rate of return on assets, they have merged together and they call it net interest cost. In IAS 19, erstwhile IAS 19, typically what they used to do is, they used to use a different rate of interest for interest cost and a different rate of interest on the expected rate of return on assets. Typically in the local GAAP also, we use a discount rate for calculating the discount rate, which is based on your government bond yields. We use it to calculate the interest cost. And the expected rate of return on assets is what your assets backing the liabilities earn. Typically you earn 9% or whatever LIC, if you are having a plan which is LIC, whatever the rate in class. And that is what we use as the expected rate of return on assets. The IAS 19 revised, erstwhile used to do this, but what they have said now is, they said now you cannot use two different rate of interest for calculating the interest cost and the return on assets. You necessarily have to use the same interest cost for calculating both the line items. And in an Indian, probably when you are going in for, I think, Ind AS, which is called the Ind AS 19, which is IAS 15, accounting standard 15, is now going to be transitioned probably 2 years down the line on the same lines as the IAS 19R. In an Indian scenario, or people who are reporting under IAS 19R may have to adopt this approach of using the same interest rate for calculating both the line items. But in Indian scenario, we don't have too much of issue because typically our interest cost, which is based on the government bonds, is very close to the return on the assets. Maybe you are using an 8.5 or 8.7 for your discount rate, and you will be using a 9% again for your expected rate of return on assets. It's not much different. Whereas in a UK company, a European company where this IAS 19 actually is impacting, they have a 9% return or 8% return on expected rate of return on assets and a 4% return because that's what their government bond is. So they have a huge impact. Typically for an Indian company, there's not much of a change. And again, they would not be reporting the net interest as two line items. They'll be reporting under a single line item. In case of US GAAP, again, it is similar to the account, our local GAAP. So there's not much difference between the US GAAP and accounting standard 15 as far as the interest cost is concerned. Yeah.
Where amortization is provided in US GAAP, how is that amount computed? What goes into P&L and what goes into OCL?
Either they have three options. One is to recognize immediately in the profit and loss account, and one is through OCI, and other is amortization. Now, if you are using an amortization approach, the amortized amount, whatever they calculate, that goes into P&L. So what gets calculated as amortized amount is the actual gains and losses which is not recognized. That means which you carry forward for your next year, that less your 10% of your assets or liabilities. 10%, whichever is higher. If your asset is higher, you take the 10%. If your liability is higher, you take the 10%. That you divide over your future working of the liability. Suppose if your balance future service is 10 years, you divide that amount by 10 years and that is your amortized amount. Only that amount will go into your profit and loss account. And the rest you carry forward again. You add the rest into your carry forward amount and carry forward every year. So that's how the USD works. That's what is called a corridor approach. Probably, as I mentioned earlier, it's to avoid the volatility in your profit and loss account in order to maintain, not to have a huge impact on P&L. This is what was about. That was mainly on the profit and loss account, and this is on the balance sheet. So typically all your retirement benefit year liability you calculate year on year, and then a portion of it you need to recognize during the year. What needs to get recognized during the year is what is the cost, which is according to accounting principles, what is the cost you incur on the retirement benefits during the year, and you need to show the amount in the balance sheet as well. Now the way what needs to be shown in the balance sheet is different, and it actually is very very prescribed in each of the GAAPs. So if you look at the accounting standard 15, you just need to show the either the excess of assets over liabilities or liabilities over assets. So what you need to show is the net funded status. Assets over, that's what you need to show, very clear. In the IAS 19, earlier it was either you need to show the excess of assets over liabilities or liabilities over assets, which is the net funded status, or you needed to show the whatever goes into the OCI if you use the corridor approach. But now the revised IAS 19, you need to show only the net funded status. Similarly for US GAAP, again you need to show only the net funded status in your balance sheet. In case of presentation in respect to the presentation of all these costs, if I look at all the financial statements which is there in the website or any of the financial statements I see, I only find a single line item which says retirement expense, or it says the liability expense. So this is what presentation is about, the retirement benefits. That's same for accounting local GAAP and the US GAAP. Whereas in the IAS 19 revised, what you have done is they have now split it into 2-3 bits. They said that you have to show a service cost, which is typically what is the cost incurred during 1 year of the employee puts in a 1 year of service, what is the cost incurred towards your retirement benefit. That is what you need to show separately, and your net interest, which I already mentioned, which is a combination of your interest on liabilities and expected rate of interest on assets. You need to show these two line items separately. This is how the presentation needs to be done in your profit and loss account. And the presentation in the balance sheet is a single net funded status, which is now similar in all the three GAAPs. What I talked about earlier is regarding the quantitative changes. Now, these are the numbers which go into all the three GAAPs. But what is more important is your qualitative disclosures, which is coming into your disclosure sheets. And I think many of you, when I look at all your financial statements, I find a lot of description on the plan. This is necessarily because the accounting standard 15 or US GAAP or IAS 19 prescribes it. Now, in India, typically in the local GAAP, what do we see? We just see a plan characteristics which says, okay, this is your gratuity plan. You need to pay 15/26 and into your past service into your salary. A basic detail. We don't mention anything else other than the plan characteristics in the local GAAP. The IAS 19 revised, erstwhile IAS 19 used to do the same thing. There was no detailed description of the plan, just the basic characteristics. But the revised IAS 19 now has brought out a lot of changes in the disclosures. This is typically because they wanted the users of the financial statement, that is the people, the public, who read the financial statement to understand what are the risk characteristics of the plan and how it is going to affect the company in case, because typically a retirement benefit plan in US and UK have a major impact on companies. I was just talking to probably 2-3 weeks back, I was talking to someone. So they mentioned that nowadays when they take over in case of mergers and acquisitions, they find that the retirement benefit liability actually is they actually constitute nearly 80-90% of the liability of the company. And earlier they never used to actually look at it, but now they started looking at the liability, retirement benefit liabilities. I think we would have heard that many of the companies, I mean one or two US companies, have actually folded because the retirement benefit liability was much larger than what the company could afford to pay the employees. So in case of the revised IAS 19, because of this particular risk characteristics of the plan, the IAS 19 revised said that the disclosures have to be very very detailed. They said that not only the companies have to mention the nature of the benefits, and in case effects of the regulatory framework, typically in UK, the regulatory, it's very prescribed basis. They actually mention what is the amount of funding required for your defined benefit plan. In India, typically, we do not have any statutory requirement as to the minimum level of funding. In fact, many of the gratuity plans are unfunded. So, there's no prescription on that aspect. So, there's a lot of risk, but then that's what it is. in UK there is a minimum funding requirement, and this needs to be mentioned in your disclosures. And any restrictions on the asset, it typically they are very prescribed. So they say that okay, this asset you cannot do X, Y, Z thing. In India, there is no such restrictions. So it's fine. And extent of the plan, plan risks for entity and any concentration of risks. Typically, what it means here is, if in case the asset which is backing the liabilities is invested in, let's say 60% in oil companies or 100% in S companies, it's a big risk because there's a concentration of risk. All these needs to be declared. So there's no such prescription in AS 15, and typically in the US GAAP also, there's no such prescription. It's not very prescriptive. It is more general. In case of reconciliation in your disclosure statements, you can see that the reconciliation statement typically in local GAAP contains the reconciliation of the benefit obligation, that is your liability from previous year to the current year, and your assets also from previous, in case you are a funded plan, you have to show your reconciliation of assets from previous year to current year, and you also show your expense statement. This is your expense. So this is what is required as far as reconciliation is concerned. And I think it's broadly similar in all the three GAAPs. Only thing is US GAAP and ISR, the disclosures are much more complicated. If you look at the ISR, especially when you're using a corridor approach, typically a reconciliation will come when you're carrying forward the unrecognized actual gain and losses, and you add the current year gain and loss and you reduce the amortized amount, you sort of need a more prescriptive disclosures. So that makes it a bit more complicated. Similarly for IS-19R, now that they have brought in the OCI concept, the disclosures are becoming a bit more prescriptive. Indian GAAP, the disclosures are fairly straightforward because you don't really carry forward anything. Except for the past service costs, which we defer it over the non-vested, we defer it over the deferment. Plan assets. In an Indian GAAP, we just need to show that the plan assets is, what are the classes of plan assets? We typically show that it is invested in property, debt or equity. All the gratuity plans are with LIC or some other insurance company. So it's a single line item saying life insurance company. But are anyone aware, or any of you aware, what is the type of investments which LIC is investing in? I mean, I don't think so, because it's not very transparent. Nor am I aware, frankly, even I don't know in which assets LIC is investing in. But only thing is, every year they give a statement that you earn a return of 9%, 10%, or whatever. So we are satisfied with that. But we really don't know what are the amount type of assets which they are investing in, what are the concentration of risk. See, we are, Mercer is a global, we have a lot of accounts which is coming to us globally. And all these place a lot of emphasis on the assets in which the funds are invested in. And we are unable to tell them in which funds, in which type of debt instruments, in which type of instruments the LIC is investing in. So they're really amazed. They're saying, how can it be so not transparent? But that's what it is. If you look at the IS-19 and US GAAP, they're very prescriptive. And they need to be very transparent in disclosures with respect to what type of assets the liabilities, which is assets which are backing the liability, needs to be invested in, and that needs to be disclosed typically for the users of the financial statements. Erstwhile, they used to have a similar classification as the local GAAP, but now they've said that you need not divide the assets into property, debt, equity, or anything. What you need to do is you need to classify this asset according to the risk characteristics. That means whether the asset is risky or not, you need to classify the assets according to that, and also you need to mention whether the assets are traded actively in the market or not. You need to mention specifically that. That's a change they brought about now. In US GAAP as well, though not as prescriptive as accounting IS-19, they still have a certain amount of risk characteristics which needs to be mentioned in the disclosures regarding the assets backing the liabilities. Is there something?
Is it okay if I stop you?
Yeah, of course. I've become very monotonous then. I myself, I agree here.
A couple of questions. One question is especially on the same topic in terms of the disclosures. So industry has not been able to take the respective details about wherever the investments have happened. From where, let's say, taking an IR example, that if you have taken a scheme, which is a different scheme from LIC. So these are not transparent. At the moment, that will be converging from Accounting Chapter 15 to IS-19. So won't it be difficult even for us also to take the details from the analysis, because if it is becoming a mandatory requirement, so So is there any challenge in terms of getting the details from them, or?
That is a challenge because we do report under we now for many of the companies in India, they are European companies and we do report for them under IAS 19. So our counterparts in those countries have asked us to give us a breakup. So when we went back to the client and asked them to ask LIC as to what are the breakup in the assets, they have not given. And so we have gone back to our companies and they have expressed our inability to get this breakup. For now, they have accepted it.
But have LIC started giving the respective details because generally they do not.
They don't. They have not given it. So the status continues. It is the status quo now. So going until now, we have not been able to. Going forward, I am not sure how this is going to go.
Because otherwise, this will become a qualification. So especially that kind of disclosure that we have not been able to do all the people's mandatory.
So
Nitin,
I just to answer your question, I think by the time it becomes mandatory, LIC will also change their practices because sometimes they won't even give you the answers also. They won't insist for. So but if you insist and you tell them that this is a disclosure requirement and otherwise then the qualification going, so you will tell you. So they'll have to change their practice actually. Probably have to keep their house in order to make sure that they are giving the information which can be actually published. But they have to change.
One more thing is really difficult because what happens is all your funds is a big pool. Now, if, let's say if you are having 100 and yours is only 5 and they invest across. So it will be very difficult also for them to say, okay, yours is 10% and me will be 10%. So they don't have a segregated fund as far as the liability is concerned. It's a big, large pool and they invest across and probably they just give you the return whether it runs or not. So I think all of you are really benefited because the returns are very low.
But probably the return will also vary in that case. In case they bifurcate and classify into these categories, they must be applying whatever is their average rate of return. But in case there are different percentages, then the rate of return which they will be getting to each.
That will be difficult because they won't say if they're getting money 10 lakhs or 10 crores from X company, they're going to take this 10 crores and invest in XYZ. They're not doing this. They're going to do it only on bulk basis, basically. So I think for them it will be very difficult to clarify. What we are doing now is we are saying over and above this we say insurance manage funds. So that's what we put all the gratuity funds which we do applications for are all insurance managed funds. And probably unit link is still better because you have those
different
so wherever companies are invested in unit link funds, we are able to show the breakup. But otherwise no. That's for gratuity. For provident fund, MOBA is what our exempt provident fund, we are able to actually show clear breakup of funds. Because they do have clear breakup whenever they are managing the fund by themselves. They have an exempt provident fund. So they manage the fund by themselves, so we are able to show the breakup. That's
how do you manage, especially for the people, for the organizations which they have a subsidiary here?
Mm-hmm.
They have overseas holding,
yeah.
Which is more European than the electricity in America. So we have a subsidiary of may not be. So we are compliant with our IFRS also. That's the way that we prepare everything for people at the same time, and that's the way that we make actual relationship. So, what will be difficult for us to have that kind of disclosure?
It's a challenge basically with respect to disclosures, frankly. The numbers are fine because it's just numbers are fine. But then, especially with respect to looking at this asset comment, it's a real challenge for us because we typically go back to our counterpart and say, see, we are not able to get the data. So they do understand that we have issues and probably we do accept it. But then moment IFRS is adopted by Indian companies, then probably we would have to have more transparency. That's what is happening. And one more issue we may have with respect to numbers is asset ceiling. Not many people know what an asset ceiling is, but it's not practiced in India. What happens is when your asset holding is more than your liability, so you have an excess of funds, excess of assets, that means your fund is positive. Typically the reporting is different. What we do is we just show a negative line item. We say, okay, in your balance sheet, we say a net asset. But that's not way it needs to be reported under IFRS. What they need to do is they need to show either the negative or lower of the asset balance or zero. Which is zero, or if you're getting any refund to the plan, or if you can take credit for the future contributions. So we don't have such information at all because we can't get refund to the plan. If you look at your gratuity trust wordings, you cannot get refund to the plan. company cannot get a refund to the company will not get a refund until the last employee goes away and the trust is gone. The money will remain in the trust. The company will never get a refund. So that is what your trust rules are very clear about. So you're not going to get a refund either. Whether we can take future credit for contributions, typically in India there's no statutory requirement for minimum contributions. Our plan can go unfunded. So as far as the company is concerned, there need not be any minimum requirement. So asset ceiling does not apply as far as India is concerned. What happens is you lose out it directly goes away. So the company sort of loses it. So if you look at IAS 90, they ask us whenever the asset is more than that, or the company is fully funded. They look and compass ask us whether you want to do an asset ceiling, we say no. So these are the approaches we adopt right now.
Coming back to the second point, which was about the net interest.
Yeah.
So at present, so as you know, we are making, which is more of the government funding, which is at GSEC securities, so especially for 4 to 5%, that's what the journey comes in. So as per now, so IS 15, IS 19 will talk about more than bank base rate.
Okay, India, I think GSEC is around 8.5 to 8.6. Okay, but 4% is more for European. In Europe, they used to take. So that for them it will impact for the companies who are in Europe. But in India, who are anyway doing IS 90, they won't have too much of impact because the spread between the expected rate of return on assets and this is very small. It makes really no difference. And many of the companies we do conservatively. We say, okay, discount rate is 8.5. Your expected long term, we are supposed to use a long term rate of return on assets. Typically, you invest only in government bonds. Your discount rate is also government bonds, we invest in government bonds. So we use the same interest rate.
Can you just slightly elaborate upon the mechanism in which it works? What I say that is that A is that there is an existing liability. Year on year, there is a salary growth and then you discount it back to the present value, and the net present value is the liability as on date. We compare this value with the funded asset as of now. So, at what stage does the return on the asset start playing into this mechanism?
You see, your expected rate of return on asset will affect your expense. See, what your expense item, when you look at your expense statement.
That's not only the classification kind. Because last year I said that it was 9% and I got 8.5%. So that half percent change will affect only the P&L presentation of. What I'm saying is in terms of the net liability, net and unfunded liability or whatever it is, at what stage does the expected rate of return start playing into that formula?
See, what happens is okay, every year we need to project the expenses for the next year.
Okay.
Many of the companies, so your current service cost anyway is a projection. Your interest cost is also a projection and expected rate of return on assets is also a projection. But when you see your asset value next year, the LIC or anyone will credit an actual return, typically would be 9%. Your asset value would have increased by that amount. So the difference between the expected rate of return on asset and actual return will go into your actual returns. So
yeah, that's
okay. That's
so
the only
thing. The difference to the classification, instead
yeah.
of if it was unfunded or my position was slightly different, my funded differential in year one vis-a-vis
yeah.
what happens in year two
yeah.
would be different. So that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as linking both these rates together as the same,
okay, see, what happened in UK is they typically they can invest in equities in UK. So what happened, many of the companies used to take a return of around 9-10%. Then they were getting huge value in assets. Their liability was the same, the asset value was high. So they used to take profits on that. So in order to circumvent this.
So, but how can you still, if you are not using that return, what the purpose of you are comparing your net present value of your actual liabilities vis-a-vis the funded asset value?
Yeah, that's right. But your funded, what happened?
You are not taking the net present value of the funded asset, you are taking the actual funded asset.
No, in your P&L, what in your P&L you take that expected rate of return at 9%? What your expense will come down. So your profit and loss account will show a profit instead of a loss, actually, instead of showing an actual. See, this is all all these are like presentation items. If you take your expected rate of return at 9%, what happens to your expense table? Your profit will go up. So in UK, for India, I don't think it's an issue at all. But in UK, I think we'll take this offline because it's a bit more complicated than what I'm saying. Yeah, okay, she's there. I've already come to the, no, it's okay, I've already come to the last point of it. So one more disclosure which needed to be, which supposed to be mentioned is that sensitivity analysis. If you look at the local gap, there is no sensitivity analysis if you calculate the liability at plus 50% bps discount and minus 50% discount. Or your plus 1% salary or minus 1% salary. So typically you, the people, you need to mention all these numbers because the users of the financial statement will know how big your liability will increase with change in your discount rate or how big your liability will increase or decrease with your change in your salary assumptions. So that's why the sensitivity analysis is required. But in local gap, Indian gap, you don't really require to mention this. In a IS-19, it was not required to mention, but now in the revised IS-19, they have said that you will have to mention the changes with respect to discount rate, changes with respect to salary, in order to ascertain how your liability will be impacted with respect to a fall in the discount rate or change in your salary assumption. In US gap, again, it's not a requirement. They just need changes in financial or demographic assumption. Not required. You just have to show the change in liability with respect to medical costs, which is not really a big thing in India. So I've sort of, time is up, so sort of come to an end. I think what you as CFO and CFO Next needs to do is look at these numbers with great more care. Because going forward, what I see the way it is going forward, these numbers, when the CFOs are going to sign the report, they need to be more careful about. So, request you to actually look at it with more detail, with a more microscopic eye than what it is. Thank you. I think this is offline. Thank you.
Any other questions? We should not deny Chitra the right to answer questions. Great. Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure to have all of you here. And I hope it has been a useful and productive morning for all of us. So, I hope to see you soon. Thank you.
Thank you.